Ya está. Gracias, Nicolás, y gracias a Felipe y todos los que han puesto esto tan maravillosamente. Solamente hago la introducción en castellano. Voy a cambiar al inglés, pero estoy muy agradecido que me hayan invitado a esta conferencia. Uno se pasa años y años y años laborando en un tema que no tiene tantos siguientes, ¿no? Y ahora de repente aquí todo el mundo le interesa así que maravilloso, es un milagro. Entonces ahora a cambiar al inglés. The theological roots of Protestant iconophobia. Why iconophobia? Because I'm looking not just at the act of destroying the images, iconoclasm, but looking at why images are feared. A phobia is a fear. And Protestants developed a very, very intense fear, not just loathing, but fear of images. And the image you have here before you is here in Spain. Nuestra Señora de la Vulnerata, in the English College of Valladolid. This image was attacked by Drake's men, Sir Francis's Drake's men. And as you can see, they gouged out the eyes and hacked the face. Swords, knives, whatever. They also cut off her arms, like those Jesuits we saw floating in the ocean. And now at the English College in Valladolid, this image is venerated. And there's one feast day a year when she's taken through the streets of Valladolid. But this, to me, embodies the difference between Catholic and Protestant attitudes towards images. But I want you to think long and hard about why it is that the face is so important to iconoclasts, and especially the eyes. But a little bit of social science before we get to the theology. Images carry a restricted code of the status quo and the guardians of the status quo. Images, they encode beliefs, they encode values and systems, and they represent them physically and visually for internalization by the viewer. They're emblematic reminders of authority, power, hierarchy, order. Of course, they're also emblematic of beliefs and of theology, but they're all these things all at once. They make the transcendent immanent, they make the invisible visible, and they are bridges, or not, linking viewers and unseen reality. Of course, there's epistemology involved, and I like to say that there's an epistemological and cognitive trinity in images. They're symbols, yes, but they are intimately linked to myth, in the case of Christianity, theology, and to ritual. They're inseparable, absolutely inseparable. And they convey messages at a very deep cognitive level that involves emotion, consciousness, reason. They are many things all at once. The perfect image and the perfect metaphor have infinite meaning. And they reach people at a much, much deeper level than linear reasoning. And that is one reason they come to be feared. A little bit more social science. Clifford Geertz. Religious symbols synthesize a people's worldview. And these are Geertz's words. The way things in sheer actuality are, their most comprehensive ideas of order. And there, Geertz argues, they're inseparable from myth and ritual. And rituals are consecrated behavior, an enactment, a materialization, a realization of the worldview encapsulated in myth and symbol, a fusing of, and I love this phrase, the world as lived and the world as imagined. Geertz also argues that rituals are social glue. I like to argue that no. Yes, they're glue, yes, but they're also social dynamite. They can just as likely blow societies apart as to bring them together. The anthropologist Victor Turner argues that ritual does more than encapsulate a worldview. It instigates action. Symbolic behavior actually creates society for pragmatic purposes. And iconoclasm or iconophobia can blur the line between religious and secular very easily, precisely because religious and secular institutions employ myth, ritual, and symbol in very similar ways, sometimes in identical ways, as evidenced by this photograph of my native land. St. Che and the new St. Francis together. And I don't know what Jesus is standing on. It looks like a pineapple. I'm not sure. Yeah, it's tropical. It's a tropical Jesus. It's, you know, that's encoding a lot of messages right there, right? And iconoclasm is a victory over tyranny. Can be. It's a victory over the status quo, over the ancien régime, whatever the ancien régime happens to be. The young iconoclasts in Geneva in 1536, and they're all described as very young, actually, in one of the chronicles. They're called enfants, boys. They picked up the pieces of the images they had destroyed, went out to the street, and threw the pieces at passersby, saying, "Here we have the gods of the priests. Would you like some?" And I like to imagine those pieces, some of them hitting people on the head. Would you like some? En voulez-vous? So, iconophobia and iconoclasm have no single cause because images encode so much all at once, and they are avatars of the status quo. Religion, politics, economics, social structure, identity, etc. And just over the break, in a conversation I was having, I remembered suddenly that there was a book on the Beeldenstorm in the Netherlands that we just heard about, published back in the early 80s. No, it was published actually in the mid-70s. It argued that the iconoclasm in the Netherlands was directly related to famine, and that was the reason that the images were destroyed. You can. The reductionism goes far as to say, yeah, iconoclasm is political, iconoclasm is economic, and it's all these things. It's all these things at once. And then talk about pulling images with ropes. Felipe and I didn't plan this. This is not planned, okay? This image of Saddam Hussein being torn down with ropes. Is this vandalism or iconoclasm? Well, there is religious iconoclasm, I like to argue. And religious iconoclasm requires theological motives, even if the iconoclasts who attack the images are not fully aware of the theological foundations of their actions. Those boys in Geneva may not have understood the theology. They were wrapped up in the moment. Perhaps they were just like the teenagers in my town who loved to destroy mailboxes. But the kind of iconoclasm and iconophobia that we're interested in at this conference has a theology behind. Iconoclasm is a ritual in and of itself. It's ritualized violence, ritualized aggression. It's an act of defiance, an act of violence, an act of war, and an act of triumph all at once. And there are as many reasons and causes for iconoclasm as the number of iconoclasts involved. And even in a single iconoclast, there could be mixed motives for destroying the images. However, there is religious iconoclasm, and at its core, theology is what distinguishes iconoclasm from vandalism. And that's my argument. And there you have a woodcut by Erhard Schoen, published in 1530, that critiques the iconoclasts. And the figure you see over on the right is the New Testament gospel saying, you know, don't criticize the speck in your neighbor's eye until you take the log out of your eye. So there was ambivalence about iconoclasm in the 1530s, and Schoen is depicting this. But the motives for the iconoclasm can be as mixed can get. And there can be ambivalence. Very brief history of Protestant iconophobia. And again, Felipe and I did not plan this, right? But here's King Josiah again. And we're going to have a presentation later, I saw on the program, on Nicolas Manuel, Swiss artist. Here's his depiction of King Josiah destroying the pagan idols. But Protestant iconophobia is not new. There was extreme iconophobia in the Byzantine Empire. The Byzantine iconoclastic controversy had two phases. The first phase was they thought they had settled everything at the Second Council of Nicaea, where these following distinctions were made, which became critical for the Western Church as well. There's dulia, veneration for saints and angels. It's hyperdulia for the Virgin Mary. But then true adoration, true worship, genuine worship, only goes to God, and that is latreia, or latria in Latin. Protestants would reject these distinctions. Protestants would take a psychological approach to worship and say these distinctions are totally false, bogus. You cannot distinguish. Veneration is veneration. Worship is worship. You cannot make these distinctions. But anyway, the Second Council of Nicaea didn't settle everything because other emperors came along who were iconoclastic, and then there was a second wave of iconoclasm that ended in 842. And in the Orthodox Church, they still celebrate this as one of the major feasts of the year, is the restoration of the images. So iconoclasm's not new, Protestant Reformation. You had late medieval iconophobia among Lollards in England, among the Hussites in Bohemia. Although with the Hussites, you might notice these Hussite soldiers, Calixtines or Utraquists, in their banner, the chalice is their symbol. This is what they want. They want to receive communion, both bread and wine. And having the cup is essential to them. But Hussites didn't like images of saints or angels or anyone else being represented. But you know how Huss ends. He ends up being burned at the Council of Constance in 1415. But Hussites survive until Luther comes along. And Luther, Felipe explained this all to you. I don't have to dwell on this. He had an ambivalent attitude towards images, but he didn't attack them. He was more interested in the issues of faith alone, scripture alone, Christ alone. He's excommunicated in 1519, but notice the image of the young Luther, the monk, Brother Martin, and the earlier representation of him, and the later representation from the early 1520s, Lutherans are still kind of fond of traditional iconography because Luther not only has a halo but a nimbus, and he's being inspired by the Holy Spirit. So you have Brother Martin, who starts the Reformation, and then you have the saint and prophet Martin, venerated by his followers. But what happens is, when Luther has to go into hiding in 1521, his senior colleague, this is important, Andreas Bodenstein von Karlstadt was younger than Luther, but he was a senior colleague. Luther disappears. Karlstadt takes over at Wittenberg. And Karlstadt takes sola scriptura, Bible alone, to a new level. What about the second commandment against images? And Karlstadt begins to insist that images need to be removed. And he writes the first Protestant treatise against images, Von Abtung der Bilder, on the abolition of images. But I want you to notice that he links two things together in the title and in the text of his treatise, on the abolition of images and of beggars among Christians. Students in Wittenberg listen to Karlstadt, and students do what they have always done and still do to this day. They can go crazy very easily. And while Luther is hiding at Wartburg Castle, beginning in Christmas, on Christmas, 1521 through February of 1522, the students, again, young people, students at Wittenberg start destroying images, and Frederick the Wise, the prince, goes along with it, even though Frederick the Wise also had the largest relic collection in all of the Holy Roman Empire. If you venerated all the relics that Frederick had, you could get over 17 million years of indulgence. But here's what Karlstadt had to say. Images murder the spirits of their worshipers. I say to you, God has forbidden images with no less diligence than killing, stealing, adultery, and the other sins forbidden by the Ten Commandments. Luther hears about all this in hiding at the Wartburg, and he comes running back with a full beard that he had grown at the Wartburg, where he had pretended to be a knight named George. So, Brother Martin is gone. No more Brother Martin. Here's the Luther who comes back, preaches a series of sermons against iconoclasm, and chases Karlstadt out of Wittenberg, chases his senior colleague out of Wittenberg, the dream of every junior professor, is to get rid of the status quo. Yeah, well, Dr. Karlstadt has deserted us. On top of that, he's become our worst enemy. This is from his sermons that he preached in 1522. Outward things are indifferent, but God does not need them, and they can obscure correct worship with their glitter. Well, there's a little bit of that ambivalence, right? And then also, Luther sees both sides. He says, it would be better if we didn't have images at all because of the abuses that they give rise to. I wish they were everywhere abolished, put away, and destroyed. But, however, it is more effective to first tear them out of the heart through God's word, for when they are no longer in the heart, they can do no harm when seen with the eyes. I don't want to linger over this point. Luther had various reasons for opposing Karlstadt on iconoclasm. But in essence, what he reduced his argument against Karlstadt to was the issue of faith versus works. Back to that theme. He charged Karlstadt with returning Christians to works righteousness, telling them they had to destroy images. They had to destroy them. Luther said, no, you can't make the destruction of images necessary for salvation. It's an act of, it's a work. It's works righteousness. And he stuck to that point till his death, and also stuck to the point that it was much better to preach against images than to destroy them. But nonetheless, Lutheran artists continued to paint certain sacred images. As long as they were biblical images, they were fine. And here you have the altar panel from Wittenberg. The whole panel's on the bottom. And the bottom image is this image of Luther preaching to the elites of Wittenberg and Saxony. The walls, I don't know if you can see it clearly, they're spattered with Christ's blood. And Luther is doing what? He's preaching. He's preaching and he's pointing to Christ as the only mediator and the source of salvation. But blood is very important to Luther and to Lutherans. But Luther actually wondered one time, can deaf people be saved? Because hearing the word was so important. How are deaf people saved? Well, you know, a crucifix is a way of teaching the deaf. It's visual. So it's important. And then an image you've already seen has been explained to you. This is from the Weimar altar panel. Well, this is Cranach the Elder. This is Cranach the Younger. Following on Karlstadt's footsteps, but actually he was there before Karlstadt, Ulrich Zwingli, the reformer of Zurich, had been preaching against images earlier than when Luther came along. We could have celebrated the anniversary of the Reformation actually in 2016, because at the pilgrimage shrine of Einsiedeln, where he was preacher, Zwingli was telling people who came there as pilgrims, you've wasted your time. You don't need to come here. You don't need to venerate the sacred image of Mary here at Einsiedeln. And then when he's made people's priest in Zurich, 1519, he gets to Zurich, 1519, okay? He starts preaching against images on biblical grounds. Second commandment, very important. Same thing as Karl said, but he doesn't write anything. He doesn't write anything about it. He preaches and preaches and preaches. And lo and behold, the young people in the congregation begin to destroy images, to test the law. I won't go there because that's it. But these are Zwingli's words, right? They are not true believers who go to anyone for help other than to the one true God. And then the bottom quote, it's therefore very easy to distinguish false religion from true. It is false religion or piety when trust is put on any other than God. They then who trust in any created thing whatsoever are not truly pious. More in Zwingli to come when I get to the theology. In 1524, the images are removed in a very orderly fashion in Zurich. They actually get the guilds to destroy, to remove the images surgically. The carpenters, the stonemasons, the glazers, they go in and then they burn some of the images. And here is, to me, I don't know if, because I'm not an art historian, I don't know the authenticity of this representation. But it was very orderly. They did it behind locked doors in Zurich. They locked the church doors and let the craftsmen remove the images. Images and the mass are abolished simultaneously. That's also important to remember, because the Eucharist is an idol. Zwingli referred to it as a god of paste. And later on in Protestant terminology, in France, the consecrated host would be mocked as Dieu Blanc, white gods. Iconoclasm spreads as Protestantism spreads in Switzerland. Here are the dates: Zurich, Bern, St. Gall, Basel, Schaffhausen, Neuchâtel, Lausanne, Geneva. And notice, it's not just carved images of saints or of Christ, but even an abstract symbol such as the cross ends up being removed. And in many places, the images are burned. In some places, they tried to give the images as firewood to poor people. In one place, it kind of backfired. In Basel, it backfired because people started fighting over the images. So they just burnt them. My favorite iconoclasm story of all time from a small Swiss village. A man takes the images home as firewood. His neighbor, who is not convinced of the correctness of this, hollows out one of the images and puts gunpowder in it. And of course, when his neighbor puts that into the fireplace, it explodes. And this is written by a Catholic. Moral of the story, the man converted back to Catholicism. Because in the ritual of iconoclasm, sometimes in Switzerland, you have the images placed on trial. And they're asked to defend themselves. You have any power? Well, defend yourselves. And here's a depiction of one such instance in Wiesen, 1529. This is precisely what happened. The images were placed on trial, and then when they didn't defend themselves, they were set on fire. And it spreads throughout Switzerland. In 1528, at Bern, Zwingli came in to preach, and here's some of his words. He's pointing at the rubble that's still in the church, because in Bern it was a riot. It wasn't orderly. He's pointing at the pieces of images. He says, there you have the altars and idols of the temple. Now there's no more debating. We did it. We did it. This is beyond debate now. Let us clear out this filth and rubbish. If they had the power ascribed to them, do you think that you would have been able to behead and cripple them as you did? The point is made beautifully. In Zurich, when he stepped to the pulpit after all the churches had been cleared of images, Zwingli's first words were, now we finally have a beautiful church in which to preach. Because the walls had been whitewashed and there were no more images. But the supreme iconophobic theologian is Jean Calvin, who ruled in Geneva from 1536 to 1564. His motto was Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory. And I'll get more into Calvin's theology in a few minutes. But whatever holds down and confines the senses to the earth is contrary to the covenant of God, in which, inviting us to himself, he permits us to think of nothing but what is spiritual. I'll get to this in a minute, this material-spiritual dichotomy that the Reformed tradition, again, a distinction to be made, for the rest of this lecture. There's Lutheran Protestantism, and then there's Reformed Protestantism emanating out of Switzerland. Zwingli and Calvin are Reformed Protestants. The Lutherans have their ambivalence about images, although in many Lutheran cities there was iconoclasm, all the way up to the Hanseatic cities in what is now Latvia and Lithuania. But it is Calvin who takes the Reformed Protestant tradition and turns iconophobia into a central tenet of Reformed Protestantism. Meanwhile, across the ocean, at the very same time, the Spanish are encountering idols and destroying idols in Mexico. And they're ugly. They're so ugly and scary, and there's human sacrifice. And actually, I had this epiphany once while simultaneously reading Calvin and Bernal Díaz del Castillo, his conquest of Mexico. The language used, Bernal Díaz del Castillo is always putting an aesthetic value on the Aztec images. They're horrible idols. And he's horrified by the priests who wear the human skins and everything. But in his language, he says, yeah, we're replacing all the horrible idols with beautiful images of our Lord, his mother, the angels, and saints. And that's an altar in the cathedral, Mexico City. And that's a three-dimensional Virgin of Guadalupe. Beautiful versus ugly. That's beautiful. The other idols are ugly. Now, to the central part of my presentation. Fundamental principles of iconophobic theology. I think you can come up with more than four, but I came up with four central tenets. First, the Biblicist principle, sola scriptura. If you're going to reform Christianity according to Scripture alone, you can't get around that second commandment. The logocentrism of Protestantism. Luther wondering, can deaf people be saved? Insisting that the only source of reform and authority is the Bible is central. Second is what I call the hermeneutical principle, how you interpret religion, how you interpret reality. The web, the grid you put on reality, one of radical transcendence. I'll explain this in a few minutes. Third is the anthropological principle, which doesn't blame the images, but actually blames human beings for the problem. Turning inwards to look at the human side of the issue of idolatry. And fourth, the socioeconomic principle, how images relate to the community. And economy meaning money and wealth and monetary value, but there's also the economy that Felipe mentioned. There's the theological economy too. The first principle, in principio erat verbum, first words of John's Gospel in the Vulgate, Latin. Everything relates to the Word. Literal interpretation of the Ten Commandments in the Hebrew Scriptures. And there they are, Exodus 24:5, Leviticus 26:1. That's the first half of the biblical imperative. Second half of the biblical imperative, it's the fact that in the New Testament, you don't find images mentioned. The early church had no images. As if you read the Acts of the Apostles, you read Peter, the letters of Paul, Peter, James, any of the other epistles, there is no mention of images. So, the absence of images and the fact that the New Testament does not explicitly abrogate or remove the second commandment. There is no passage in the New Testament that says, oh, let's not pay attention to that second commandment anymore. Protestants seize on this. This is very important to them, and it's the foundation of the rest of their iconophobic theology. The hermeneutical principle of radical transcendence, I like to argue, is an inverted sort of Neoplatonism. The Orthodox Church, especially John of Damascus, during the iconoclastic controversy, had used Neoplatonism to defend images. The role that images play in worship is that there is a relationship between image and prototype, between matter and spirit, because God became incarnate. That's John of Damascus's argument, is once God became incarnate, everything changed. Matter was now related to spirit. But Neoplatonism, of course, thinks of matter as inferior to spirit. And what happens in Protestantism, you get a very curious, I call it inverted Neoplatonism, that argues that there is a negative relation between image and prototype. And here are the biblical verses used most often, especially John, Gospel of John 6:63, the spirit gives life, the flesh profits nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. The flesh profits nothing. And Galatians 5:17, the flesh craves what's contrary to the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. Now, Paul's understanding of spirit and flesh is different from the understanding Protestant interpreters put on it, but nonetheless, this is the passage they keep going back to. For Paul, flesh, sarx, means much more than just matter. It's the human condition. And who can we blame for this inverted Neoplatonism? I blame Erasmus, the man accused of laying the egg that Luther hatched. And I wish I had come up with this version of that accusation. One of my students did in class one day, and I gave him an A+ for the whole class just for saying this. He says, Luther didn't hatch the egg laid by Erasmus. He scrambled the egg laid by Erasmus. Beautiful. I wish I could have actually paid him for that with more than an A+. The Enchiridion of Erasmus, published in 1509, which is read by Zwingli, and Zwingli will confess he abandoned Roman Catholic piety after reading Erasmus. He adored Erasmus. He bought everything and read everything written by Erasmus. But in the Enchiridion, Erasmus says all material objects are an obstacle to genuine piety. They're an obstacle because matter and spirit are so diametrically opposed to each other. The matter can never convey the spiritual. And there are a couple of quotes from Erasmus. I won't read them verbatim, but in essence, Erasmus says, matter stands in the way. And here's an argument he makes in the Enchiridion. If matter made such a difference, then how was it that Jesus ended up being crucified? He said, who could have been more blessed than Judas? He got to kiss Jesus. And then what does he do when he kisses them? He betrays him. How is this possible? The flesh, he argues, is useless to salvation. That's Erasmus's argument. Inutilem in Latin. Same as in Spanish. Inutil, useless. Absolutely useless. And he quotes the passage from John. The flesh is of no avail. And there's the look at the passage on the bottom. Why did Christ leave the apostles and ascend bodily into heaven? Surely it was because his flesh stood in their way, the way of the apostles. He tells them, it's necessary I go. So if the very physical presence of Christ is useless to salvation, inutilis ad salutem, how can you put your trust in corporeal things? And the only image of Christ, look at the top quote, the only true image of Christ is in the letters of the Bible, the letters of Holy Writ, literis, in the letters. This logocentrism Erasmus passes on to Zwingli. And guess who read Erasmus too? Karl Stott. So Erasmus can be traced back to Erasmus and to the Devotio Moderna. We don't have time to go into all this. But through the Devotio Moderna, over here in Spain, to the Alumbrados, the connections. But here's Zwingli's hermeneutical principle. He actually had two formulae. Finitum non est capax infiniti. Impossible. It gets this from Erasmus. And then the other formula, quantum sensui tribueris, tantum spiritui detraxeris. Whatever you invest in the senses, in the sensual, in the material, you take away from the spiritual. It's almost like a mathematical formula for Zwingli. God is totally other. The divine and supernatural realm is beyond the reach of the natural. The material world is inferior. That's very Platonic. But that's A, B, C, the place of knowledge and worship in Christian life. Zwingli, and then later Calvin, will argue that the biblical prohibition of images is reasonable. It's not just because the Bible tells you that images are incorrect. It's because it makes sense. It's this prohibition of images is grounded in a certain metaphysics and epistemology. and it is inherently pragmatic, for the very meaning and purpose of human existence is negated by the error and falsehood that images convey. And the error and falsehood is that they have any link at all to the spiritual. That's what's wrong. And there's a teleology here. What is the purpose of human existence? Well, correct worship is absolutely necessary. And you can't have correct worship with images. Therefore, images stand in the way of the telos, or proper end, of human beings. And then there's the epistemological dimension. How can you know God and respond to God properly? That's the purpose of human existence right there. Well, images stand in the way. This is why they're so horrible, and this is why they're so feared, because they stand in the way of salvation. They pervert knowledge, and they pervert behavior. And then Calvin. As soon as a visible form has been fashioned for God, his power is also bound to it. Men are so stupid that they fasten to God whatever they fashion in him. Hence, they cannot but adore. There is no difference whether they simply worship an idol or God in the idol. It is always idolatry when divine honors are bestowed upon an idol under whatever pretext this is done. I've been trying to get some graduate student to do a dissertation on the concept of honor that Calvin is working on, you know, early modern French or Western European conceptions of honor. Because for Calvin, the fact that honor is being given to physical images is very disturbing to God. Nothing makes God angrier than when he's dishonored. And this is central to the Calvin's iconophobia. God is so far from being like us that those things which please us most are for him most loathsome and nauseating. Yeah. Well, now we get to the anthropological principle. Turning inwards, the cause of idolatry is not matter itself, but human nature, fallen human nature. And here, original sin is the key to understanding why images are wrong, because original sin traps humans in their own self-centered sphere of existence, making us inherently prone to seek the Creator through matter, according to our misconceptions. Zwingli argued in 1525, after the images had been cleared, that all humans create inner gods or false gods. Abgud. There is no one who, as soon as he hears God spoken of, does not picture a form for himself. Every abgot, or false god or inner god, pictured in the mind finds expression in a physical idol, Götze. Very clear theology. Calvin builds on this. The strange inner god, the abgot, always comes before the idols. This is Zwingli's quote. I'm quoting directly from Zwingli. Realizing that God can't be sought in carnal material things is, and again, quoting from Zwingli, the fountainhead of true religion and the first foundation of faith. Realizing this, that God cannot be reached through matter. Calvin sharpens this. And here we have an image from 1520, Michael Ostendorfer, of the shrine to the beautiful Mary, Schöne Maria, in Regensburg, 1520. Look how Ostendorfer depicts the pilgrims falling to their knees, actually falling on the ground. They're falling on the ground not because they're exhausted by their pilgrimage, but because of this attitude they have towards the image as embodying the Virgin Mary. I have a lot of quotes here from Calvin. I don't think I need to read them all to you. I don't know if these PowerPoints could be made available to the conference participants so that they can, you know, look at them on their own time and reflect on these passages. In essence, what these quotes are all about is Calvin's concept of the semen religionis, the seed of religion planted in every human being. We all have the seed of religion planted in us by the Creator. But because of original sin, the seed can only germinate negatively. It germinates, it's like a twisted plant that grows instead of the good plant, a bad plant comes out. And that inclines us to seek God in matter, in the material world. So we're all, Calvin will argue, inborn idolaters. We're prone to idolatry. We can't resist idolatry. It's in our nature. It's the same as any other sin in the Ten Commandments. You know, we're tempted to envy our neighbor and steal our neighbor's stuff. Somebody annoys us, we're tempted to kill them. Same thing with images. In essence, here's Calvin's argument. Right? You put up an image in a sacred context, be it a church, be it a crossroads, could be outside, doesn't have to be in a church, but if the image has a sacred context and you pass by, you will be drawn to that image and you will be drawn to offer it veneration. To pollute yourself, pollute your community, and dishonor God. They can't be resisted. So, the one quote I will read, every one of us, even from his mother's womb, is a master craftsman of idols. Relics, too, are impossible to resist. Those consecrated hosts, they're impossible to resist. So Calvin gets these desperate letters from his followers in France. If my nephew is being baptized in a Catholic baptism, can I attend? And he says, no, you cannot cross the threshold. You cannot go into that space that's full of idols. You just cannot. No mixing whatsoever. So that means his followers have two choices. Exile or martyrdom. Very tough choice to make. This is how much Calvin fears the images and how much he projects this fear onto his followers in France. Now, a sociologist would say, well, he's just trying to build his community and establish it. Yeah, of course he is. But there's this theological component that I don't think can be overlooked. Again, any reverence paid by anyone to an image angers God and results in punishment. When God is dishonored, pardon my English, when God is dishonored, God gets pissed. He gets angry, and there's retribution. So here's Matthias Gehring's depiction of the collapsing Catholic Church in 1547. Of course, this is the result of idolatry. Notice all the demons circling the collapsing church. This is all due to the idolatry. So innate in us is superstition, the bottom quote, the least occasion will infect us with contagion. He gets medical. He gets scientific. Dry wood will not so easily burn when coals are put under it as idolatry will seize and occupy the minds of men when the opportunity presents itself to them. And who does not see that images are sparks? No, nay, torches, which are sufficient to set the whole world on fire. And then the devil will be placed in charge of everything we do. They're scary, those images. The fourth and last of these principles. There is a socioeconomic and ethical dimension which Karlstadt emphasized. Once you empty images of their spiritual value, all that is left is the economic value. Since images are entirely material with no transcendent value or any miraculous effect on the welfare of the community, their monetary value seemed all the more earthly and contrary to Christian charity. Why spend all of these gulden or whatever the currency was on images when we have the poor. This is a constant argument, constant Protestant argument. Karlstadt made the link so essential. Martin Bucer in Strasbourg argued that images were the decoy birds, Lockvogel, of the clergy. There are ways that the clergy, so it's also a means of oppression, of the elites oppressing the subalterns. Well, you keep people ignorant. You keep them illiterate. You tell them images are the libri pauperum, the books of the poor, instead of really teaching them. This is the way that the clergy amass their power and their wealth. Bucer argued that images were a means of luring Christians into spending money on the clergy and their churches, and that this was all both against faith and love. Wooden images are distributed as firewood. This also happened in Basel. They didn't just distribute the images. They took all of the silver and gold vessels, melted them down, put them in the town treasury. They took the vestments, liturgical vestments, and gave them to poor people too. And for some time in Basel, you would see poor people walking around dressed in liturgical vestments and in the wintertime because they're nice and thick and they keep you warm. In the Netherlands, I love this. In the Netherlands, after that initial Beeldenstorm of 1566, well, the Dutch got very smart. They sold the images to Catholics elsewhere because they're worth money. They saw the monetary value. They saw the value in not destroying these items. This is how some amount, I don't think anybody's done research on this, some considerable amount of Netherlandish art has survived. It's because it was sold rather than destroyed. So, Pope Gregory I in the 6th and 7th century had argued that images were the books of the poor. Protestants redefined the relationship between images and the poor. Images are dangerous. Also, this part of the iconophobia, because they help the clergy to suppress literacy and Bible reading by the laity. And iconophobia thus leads to a redefinition of Christian education and of the laity's access to the divine. And iconophobia spreads. This is my own crude map, so I'm no cartographer. But three areas in particular, iconoclasm was intense. Northern Switzerland, the Netherlands, and Scotland. But in England, and even in Ireland, in France, in Hungary, in Poland, where many of the nobles turned Calvinist, there was iconoclasm. It could be found in many places. And there are actually many artistic depictions of this Reformation iconoclasm. I found a few. This image we have seen, this one was hand-colored, I think. This one we've also seen. It makes no difference whether you pray or shit in your pants. It's over for us. That's what the idols are saying. Which lead to the development of a Reformed Protestant or Calvinist aesthetic, perhaps best represented by these paintings of Dutch churches. St. Bevo in Haarlem. That's the beautiful church Zwingli was talking about. Now we finally have a beautiful church in which to preach. When we go to the Escorial, I don't know if we'll be able to see the Sagrada Forma. This is one of those bleeding hosts. It was stepped on by a Dutch iconoclast. And the three dots, blood spots, are the nails in the heel of the iconoclast boot that made the host bleed. Well, it was brought to Philip II, and he enshrined it at the Escorial, and then it became one of the more important relics This is a relic. It's also an image. It's like La Vulnerata in Valladolid. It represents Protestant iconoclasm. All the Habsburgs were very devoted to the Sagrada Forma, including the unfortunate genetic mutant Carlos II. I was astonished, whereas most of us, if we go back eight generations, have 128 ancestors. Carlos II only had 64. Carlos II is depicted there at the Escorial. Maybe we'll get to look at this, at that very room, venerating the Sagrada Forma. And Philip II rescued relics from the Low Countries and from Germany, which made their way all the way down to Genoa and around and up to the Escorial. 7,000 relics rescued from Protestant iconoclasts. Erasmus was not beloved in Spain by some people. I think it's very revealing what happens here. Again, coming to a close here. These images of saints from England with their faces hacked off. I love St. Margaret on the upper left. Poor Margaret. Actually, that image was buried outside a church in Kent somewhere in England. And it was rediscovered when they were doing work on the foundations of the church. And it's been reinstalled in the church in a very nice niche. And the thing is, it's not the whole image. St. Margaret is always stepping on a dragon. Is that they hacked off Margaret's head, but they didn't hack off the dragon. This is from a book in the Biblioteca Nacional here in Spain. Someone did not like Erasmus, defaced him. What's the point of showing you these images, right? It's the phobia, the fear of what is wrong, right? Notice that Erasmus has had his eyes gouged out and his lips are sewn shut. Shut up. Enough of this logocentrism. And there is no depiction, I think, better than this of the Catholic response to Protestant iconoclasm. This painting by Alonso Cano. Whenever I'm in Madrid, if there isn't a long line at the Prado and I can get in, I like to stand by this image and listen to the comments people make. Especially American tourists. I once heard this girl turn to her friend and say, "This is religion?" And I was tempted to say, "Yes, this is what religion is all about." Cano takes a medieval legend, going back to the 12th century, that Bernard of Clairvaux, venerating an image of Mary, was fed miraculously milk from her breast. And there are medieval depictions of this. Actually, it's a Catalan legend. It first surfaces in either Mallorca or Menorca, up there somewhere. But Cano, what I love about this image is that Mary's image, it's an image, it's quite clear. It is not, well, is it clear or not? It's kind of confusing. Is it an image that's squirting milk in Bernard's mouth, or is it the Virgin Mary? That ambivalence, I think, is intentional. And this is the ambivalence, the blurring of the line between the material and the spiritual, the heavenly and the earthly, that you find in the Catholic response to Protestant iconophobia, where Catholics become more interested even than they were in medieval times to empowering the image and to blurring the distinction between material and spiritual. And something I've noticed too, that in almost all representations of miracles such as this that involve divine ecstasy, or a miracle of the sort, the artist will have an eyewitness in the depiction. Here we have one eyewitness. In some of these, you have more than one eyewitness. Kind of, the skepticism is in the background. The skepticism is the epistemological horizon that Catholics live with. Catholics know that Protestants are destroying images. Saint Teresa of Avila is very painfully aware of the fact that those Lutherans over there are destroying images. And she can't understand why. She just cannot understand why, which makes her pray all the harder for those Lutherans who just don't get images. And that's it for...